to Staying the Course. Join us as we navigate the uncompromised Word of God with Pastor Brett Peterson.
I love your Word. I love the way.
We are currently going through the book of Exodus on Sunday mornings, but we came to Exodus chapter 4, verse 21. And you can turn there if you want, and we find something very interesting. For the first time in the Bible, why don't we just read it? Exodus chapter 4, verse 21, and we did go a few verses past that last week and the week previous, but Exodus chapter 4, verse 21, and it says, "The Lord said to Moses, 'When you go back to Egypt, see that you perform before Pharaoh all the wonders that I have put in your power. But I will do what?'" What does it say there? "I'm going to harden his heart," right? "I'm going to harden his heart so that he will not let my people go." And we have gone on a four-week journey, and this week, 5 weeks, in Calvinism versus Arminianism. I really believe that it's important to note that we serve a God of love and mercy and grace who desires all men to come to the knowledge of the truth. We have established that God is a God that truly wants every man, woman, and child on the planet to come to repentance. We've talked about free will. We've talked about this great debate. Is it a God of mercy and grace or what? And the question is Calvinism scripturally right or not? And I know for some of you, you're disengaging right now. It's like, oh, this is a theological study. Don't worry. Just watch me. I'm so funny up here. You're going to laugh. You're going to have fun, guys, right? You're like, yeah, sure, right. All right, the tulip, just to remind us, total depravity. And this is the 5 points of Calvinism. Everyone is born totally depraved and reprobate and will burn in hell. We have already established that that simply is not the case, scripturally, and all we did is run to scripture. Unconditional election. God could have chose to save everybody, but for some reason, before the foundation of the world, he picked a few that will go to heaven, and everyone else, make no mistake about it, will burn in hell. What's the L stand for? Limited atonement. Hey, Jesus did not pay for all mankind's sins on the cross of Calvary, but only for the elect. Irresistible grace, you have no free will. If God chose you, you will be made to choose him. And the last one, P? Perseverance of the saints. I really believe that. Man, when you're a son or daughter of Christ, of God himself, through Christ, you are in his arms. Nothing can take you from that. And though you may stray from the path, he will, as a loving father, woo you back to repentance. Have you ever experienced that in your life? You know, for me, I was born again in 1968. Every time I ran away from the Lord, never doubted his existence. You know, how can you doubt what you know? You know what I mean? I mean, when you know God, it's like, okay, Lord, I'm going to do my own thing here, but I'll come back to you someday. And he always first tried to woo me back with kindness. You ever experienced that? Come on, son, come back to me. But eventually the discipline of the Lord will come. So I believe once you're truly a son or daughter of Christ, man, nothing can snatch you out of his hands. He will keep you. So the question is, and we're going to end this discussion, and I have so much more to go, but we just need to get back to the book of Exodus. So this Sunday, this is the end of this debate. If you want to talk more about it, email me. Let's get together, because it is imperative that we have a right understanding regarding this debate, because it is all about the character of our God. Salvation by fate or salvation by faith? That's the question. Either you have no free will, and by God's sovereign predetermined plan, everything you do, everything that happens to you in life, guess what? God made it happen. Or it's all about faith, and faith actually indicates free will. Do you know that? The whole idea to believe is meaning you choose to believe. Now, I know a Calvinist will say, but if it's dependent on your choice to believe, then your salvation is dependent on you, not God. You ever hear that argument? The problem with that argument is if I wanted to give you guys a drink of water, right, And I said, hey, it's yours. All you got to do is get it. I choose you to have this water. And you either chose it or not. It didn't depend on you to get the water. I got the water. I did everything. You simply received the free gift. Does that make sense? So let's run through some verses really quick. It's actually two different gospels, I really believe. Faith is believing and trusting in God with everything you are. It is belief plus proof. It's not a blind leap. I really believe it is unfortunate that many pastors say, even if God wasn't real, I would still be a Christian because it's such a great life. What does Paul say about that? If Christ hasn't risen from the dead, what does Paul say? We of all people, our faith is in vain, and we are of all people to be most pitied. You see, I believe there is proof, not only in nature and the conscience that God has placed in everyone's heart, the law of God, but the word of God and fulfilled prophecy. So the character of God, according to Calvinism, is this: God enacts laws that mankind are unable to obey. Think about that. What's that called? Throughout history, when a tyrant would enact laws that the people couldn't obey, it's tyranny. It's difficult. God will eternally judge mankind for not obeying laws that they couldn't obey in the first place. Does that sound like God is a just and righteous judge? God could save everybody, but chooses not to. And God shows partiality to a select few, and the rest will suffer in hell forever. Now, I don't know about you, but that God is not the God of the Bible. It's not the God that I serve. The God that we serve is a God of love and mercy and grace. And last week we established that there is no partiality with God. We went over at least four verses that clearly indicate that. God is love, and he doesn't show favoritism. So to love the God of Calvinism, we must close our eyes to the cruel, tyrannical, arbitrary attributes of a Calvinistic God. Now, I know maybe some of you were raised in the Reformed tradition and you find this message offensive. What I find offensive is the attack on the character of God by those who hold to such position. That God is actually the cause of all sin. He is the will of all sin. It's part of his sovereign plan. His legislation is literally unjust and impossible to keep, and he has cruel penalties for those that don't keep what they cannot keep in the first place. That is not just. That is not right. That is not merciful. That is not love. According to a Calvinist, we are so reprobate that we cannot choose to do any moral or ethical good, and especially to pursue God in our own free will or our own volition. So Calvinism is self-evidently false. How do these self-evident truths refute Calvinism? Well, in Romans chapter 2, we read that those Gentiles that do not have the law but obey instinctively what? The law that God has placed in their heart, they will be judged on that day by how they respond to the conscience, the law of God that he's placed in their heart, meaning they have the ability to obey it. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. You know, it's really interesting to me that there are the justified, the saved, through Jesus Christ. Then there are those at the white throne judgment, the sheep and the goats, that will be judged by their works, not faith. Guess what? That's not us. You see, once we have faith in Jesus Christ, the judgment is done. We are proclaimed righteous. That's justified. It's just as if you've never sinned. So it's not based on your goodness, but on Christ's finished work on the cross of Calvary. But there are a people that will be judged by their works. When you read in Revelation chapter 21, the great white throne judgment, you see, they come before there, and what does it say? They will all be judged by their works. Yes. In Matthew chapter 5, we find, hey, you didn't give me a drink of water, Jesus said, so because of that, what? What you've done to the least of these, you've done unto me. You're not going to make it. Those people are judged by works, not faith. But Christians, the good news of the gospel, we're judged by simply our faith in Jesus Christ, the finished work. So these self-evident truths, Calvinism teaches that God is the author and creator of sin. Now, I don't care how they try to spin that. Folks, if you believe the 5 points of Calvinism, you believe in a sovereign God that literally everything is predetermined by God. There is no free will. It teaches that all men are sinners and reprobate from the sin of Adam, and they base it mainly on this verse. Let's look at it, Romans 5:18. So then, as through one transgression, there resulted condemnation to who? All men. What does that mean? Hey, we are all condemned. We are all going to sin, every one of us, all mankind, everyone in the whole world. But now here's what's really interesting. If we base our belief on that, on this one verse, and there's a few others, what about the rest of Romans 5:18? Even so, through one act of righteousness, there resulted justification of life to who? All men. So if you believe that all men are born condemned, born reprobate, then you also must believe, in the same language, that all men will be saved. And we know that simply is not true. Who is condemned? The Bible, we've proved it last week and in subsequent weeks. We've gone over this 4 weeks. Who's condemned? Those who sin. Prior to sin, a little innocent child is not born reprobate. In fact, the Bible made it clear, and let's review it here in a second. The Bible doesn't teach any of that. Salvation by faith or fate, it's two different gospels. Literally, Calvinism is like atheism. And how are they alike? Do you know that most atheists say there's no free will? Do you know that? You are driven. Every decision you make is a result of natural animal instincts. Do you know that? It's programmed. So you are simply an animal. There's no free will. Calvinists and atheists deny self-evident truths. They deny free will. They say we're both born animals with no capacity to make moral and ethical choices. I fully disagree with that. We are born precious in the sight of the Lord. We are fearfully and wonderfully made in our mother's womb. And we're going to go over some verses about children and about infants. God is love. Do you know that? He's light. He's good. He's gracious. He's merciful. He's forgiving. He's wanting to bless. But sometimes he can't because he's unable to go against his word. Do you know that? Do you know God can do anything he wants but what? Oh, a few things. He cannot go against his word. The truth is God is sovereign and has unlimited power, yet he has chosen to limit himself. He is self-limiting. What do I mean by that? When he makes a promise, guess what? He can't break it. He cannot break that. When there's a promise in Scripture, you can bet your life on it. God cannot lie. He cannot sin. Do you know that? You know, there's a lot of things God cannot do. He will not do some things spelled out in his word. So he is self-limiting according to the proclamations and covenants that he's made and promises in the word of God. So even though God is sovereign and all-powerful, there are some things he simply cannot do because it is contrary to his character. You think God could make an unjust judgment? There's no way. Does God show favoritism? Absolutely not. Does God show partiality? We proved it last week. No. So that alone refutes Calvinism to its core. Can God do anything? Yes. Will he do anything? No. God has already said that he'll do in many situations what he'll do in the Word of God. That's why the Word of God is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Guess what? The Bible says when you continually disobey the command of God in Scripture, guess what? God's discipline will come. Do you know that? You know, the Bible says something very hard. You reap what you sow. Do you think that's all about free will and works and all of that? It's amazing to me when Christians come to me and say, why is God allowing this to happen? Do you know that we live in enemy territory, in a fallen world, that this world right now is under Satan's domain, and it's not until the second coming of Christ that it is then returned to Christ? It's interesting that Satan offered to give Jesus Christ what when he was tempted? All the kingdoms of the world. He literally said, I'm going to give you the world right now. You can be king of the world if you bow down to me. Satan will give a man that power probably very soon, the Antichrist, the false Christ, the false Messiah. It's going to be really interesting. God says in Psalm 89:34, my covenant I will not break, nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. What does that mean? God's not going to lie. He's going to keep his promises. You can pray the promises of God. When I feel down, I go through the promises of God and the Word of God. It's like, man, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all your needs are going to be met. Do you know that? So when my needs aren't being met, all of a sudden I question, okay, Lord, am I really seeking you first? Inevitably, the times of my life when I'm struggling are the times of my life when I wasn't seeking first Christ and his righteousness. He keeps his promises, saints of God. We know that he cannot lie because of Titus 1:2, and we know the father of lies, the devil, John 8:44. Yet people still talk about God as if he breaks promises. This simply is not the case. The enemy comes like a roaring lion seeking whom he what may devour. Not God. He's not up there saying, man, I can't wait for you to make a mistake so I can just punch you, so I can just make your life miserable. No, God is, man, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Oh, a broken and contrite heart, oh, I do not despise, says the Lord God Almighty. He loves you despite your faults. He wants to help you through life. God is a promise keeper. Calvinism says everything good comes from God. And by the way, everything bad comes from God too. What does the Bible say about that? Yeah, the idea is every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, right? And what does the enemy bring? All evil, pain, suffering, death, all of it comes from sin and Satan himself, because God is a God of grace and mercy and love. God cannot go against the laws he's established and the covenants he's enacted. Christ said in John 10:9, I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved and go in and out and find pasture. The thief, speaking of Satan, comes only to steal, to kill, and to destroy, to steal your health. You know, some sickness comes from the enemy. Do you know that? Paul had a buffeting spirit, the Bible says. This was a sickness, a physical ailment, and God didn't allow him to be healed so that what? So that God's grace would be sufficient, so Paul wouldn't exalt himself in pride. So he had this physical ailment. The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but Christ came that you might have life and have it abundantly. When you run to the Lord Jesus Christ, you can have joy and peace that transcends understanding in the midst of a dark and ugly life. So a quick review of what we've gone over and established in Scripture. When someone is born, they're born with the law of God written on their hearts. Their names are written in the book of life. This is all over the Bible. We talked about it. And they will be judged by their works, not faith. That's everyone in the world. So if there's a pygmy in some tribe that's never heard the gospel, God's law is already in their heart. And at the white throne judgment, the cool thing is there's not only goats that will burn in hell, but there's sheep. They're not Christians, folks. These people are judged by their works. They are people that never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, yet for some reason they will not burn in hell. Are they saved? No. Are they justified? No. Are they part of the church? No. Where's the church going to spend eternity? The New Jerusalem on the new earth. Where's the nations that are on the new earth from if they're not part of the church? Turn to Revelation, if you would, really quick. Chapter 21. And here we have the final judgment is over. And by the way, just go back to chapter 20, verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose presence the earth and heaven fled away and no place was found for them. So we know at the end of the millennial reign of Christ, this heaven, this earth will be destroyed. And Peter, we're told that it'll burn, the elements will burn with great heat. Verse 12, and I saw the dead, the great, the small, standing before the throne. Guess who's not standing there? We're not. All the Christians are already raptured, had the bema seat of Christ, the reward seat of Christ. We're already reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. We're glorified. We are not part of this judgment, but everyone in the world except Christians, the bride of Christ, will be in this judgment. Notice what it says. Standing before the throne, verse 12b, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged from the things which are written in the books according to what? Their deeds. Folks, we are not judged by our deeds. Aren't you glad of that? Amen. I mean, we simply are proclaimed just. The church is not part of this judgment. Now note this, and the sea gave up their dead which were in it, death, hell, Hades gave up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every one of them, according to their deeds. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone's name who was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. Then the new heaven and new earth are made. In Revelation chapter 21, the new Jerusalem descends on the new earth. It's a city that's 1,500 miles long, wide, and high. That's where we live for eternity. But on the new earth, guess what it says? Continue on. Verse 22 of Revelation 21. And I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. And the city had no need for sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God has illuminated it, and the lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. Who are those people? They're not part of the church. They are not saved. They are not justified. They are not, they are the bride of Christ. This is a group of people that at the white throne judgment, as the sheeps and the goats were thing, they're not saved, they're not part of the church, so make no mistake about it. There's only one way to be saved, that's through Jesus Christ. But apparently there are those that obeyed the law that God had put in their heart, and they made it to the new earth rather than hell, because we serve a merciful, what? Just God. Flip, if you would, just to establish it, Romans chapter 2. Starting at verse 14. For when Gentiles do not have the law, do instinctively the things of the law, these not having the law are a law to themselves, in that they show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience bearing witness, and their thoughts alternately accusing or else defending them on the day when, according to my gospel, God will judge the secrets of men through Christ Jesus. So we have a population, nations and kings living on the new earth. They're not in hell, and they aren't part of the church. All I know is we serve a just and merciful God. A just and merciful God. Sin is not imputed to those who do not know the law. Do you know the Bible says that? Boy, we went over it in depth. We do not become calloused and hardened until we practice sin. The Bible is very clear. We covered all those verses. We are not born calloused and reprobate and hardened, but as we begin to practice sin, our hearts become calloused and reprobate and hardened. The good news is the gospel. Man, as Christians, we will not be judged by our works. We will simply be judged by our faith. I don't know about you. That's why it's good news. Because my works are wretched. I think Paul said it well in Romans. Oh, wretched man that I am. But thanks be to God. There's only two verses in the Bible that clearly state children are born depraved. I want to go over those really quick. Psalm 51:5. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. That's one. That's David speaking. And Psalm 58:3, the wicked are estranged from the womb. These who speak lies go astray from birth. Now, this would seem to indicate that Calvinism were correct, that we are born reprobate, correct? These are really part of Hebrew poetry. It's called a hyperbole in Hebrew poetic form. It's kind of like if I were commanding a battalion and I asked a soldier, are you ready to go to the front lines and scout out the land? You might have to fight. You might even die. And the soldier might say, what? Man, I was born ready. Okay, he wasn't really born ready, but it's a hyperbole. It's a way of emphasizing the fact that, man, I was born ready, all of that. It's all a Hebrew poetic form. David was referring to the sinfulness of the world, not his own personal state. Fact is, David said that he served God from his womb. Psalm 22:9, yet you are who brought me forth from my womb. You made me trust when upon my mother's breast. And Psalm 22:10, the next verse, upon you I was cast from birth. You have been my God from my mother's womb. So which is right? Actually, neither. They're both hyperbole. Neither was David born sinful, and neither did he worship God inside his mother's womb. They're simply a hyperbole to make emphasis, I was born ready. It's exactly like that phrase. So it's interesting to know that Hebrew poetic form, I was born ready, this ideology, cannot establish doctrine or dogma. In fact, the Bible actually says children are born innocent, that God loves children. They aren't born reprobate or depraved. They have to actually reject God and practice sin to become reprobate. Romans 1:28, and just as they did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do things which aren't proper. The idea is they weren't born that way. It wasn't a state of birth. It was a consequence of repeated sin. This Romans chapter 1 text, by the way, it goes through, they deny God, they exalt man, they seek pleasure, they embrace homosexuality, and they become entirely reprobate. That's the progression of the downfall of many cultures in the world. Is America heading that direction? It's a sad fact, but we are. Folks, we need to stand for truth now more than ever. This nation is literally entering that last stage. The first stage, deny God. Have we done that as a nation? Exalt man? Seek pleasure, embrace homosexuality, and then be turned over to a reprobate. And Obama himself said, we need to shift the biblical view on gay marriage. How do you do that? It's like, okay, 2 + 2 = 4. You want me to say 2 + 2 = 5? It's just, I can't do it. It contradicts God's law. So Spurgeon said this, I rejoice to know that all souls of infants, as soon as they die, speed their way to paradise. Think of what a multitude there is of them in heaven. Charles Spurgeon, Spurgeon at his best, page 95. So Matthew 18:12 says, what do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them go astray, does he not leave the 99 on the mountains and go search for the one that is strayed? If it turns out that he finds it, truly I say to you, he rejoices over it more than over the 99 which have not gone astray. So it is not the will of your Father in heaven that one of these little ones perish. Do you know that God pursues you? How many of you have experienced the pursuit of God? The hound of heaven. No matter what you do, he's pursuing you, wooing you back to him. He loves you so much. David knew children go to heaven. We know when David's son was dying. Man, he was sick and dying, and David put on sackcloth and ashes and rent his clothes and fasted and wept before the Lord. But when his child finally died, what did David do? Man, he got up and took a shower and anointed himself, and his servants were like, what? When your son was alive, you wept, and now your son is dead and you rejoice? How did David respond in Samuel? He said this, while the child was yet alive, I fasted and wept, for I said, who can tell whether God will be gracious to me and the child may live? But now he is dead. Wherefore should I fast? Can I bring him back again? I shall what? Go to him, but he shall not return to me. What does that mean? Hey, that little baby was not born reprobate. It went right to Abraham's bosom, and that's where the good people went. That's where Christ went down and released those captives, and David knew he was going to see him again. I mean, this is one verse that establishes that if a child was born reprobate and their name was not recorded in the book of life, they wouldn't have gone to the good place. They would have went to the other place. David knew it. Jesus states, "Take heed that you despise not one of these little ones, for I say to you that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father, which is in heaven." The little ones have angels in heaven that always behold the face of the Father, Hebrews 1:14. You know, the Bible says angels are what? Ministering spirits sent forth to minister to who? Children of God. The idea is it could be that every child has a guardian angel. That every child is born not reprobate but innocent before God, and it's not until they, with their free will, choose to sin repeatedly that their heart becomes hardened against the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ and a God that loves them. Scripture tells us that all men are actually born upright. We find it in Ecclesiastes 7:29. "Behold, I found only this, that God made men upright, but they have sought out many devices." The idea here is simple. God made us upright, and we, after we reach the age where we can discern right from wrong and choose wrong, it is at that point that we are separated from the love of God. Zechariah 12:1, "The burden of the word of the Lord concerning Israel, thus declares the Lord, who stretches out the heavens and lays the foundation of the earth and forms the spirit of man within him." He forms the spirit of man within him. Do you think God forms an evil spirit? No. Even demons themselves were angels with free will or free volition, and they chose to rebel against God. Psalm 139:13 says, "You formed me in my inward parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. I will give thanks to you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well." He puts the spirit of man within him. There's the Romans verse again. "For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there is no law." So someone, before they know the law, does not have sin imputed. In fact, Jesus said in John 9:41, "If you were blind, you would have no sin. But since you say we see, your sin remains." What's he saying there? Man, if you don't know the truth, you can't be accounted to sin because you're not even aiming for the mark. We know sin is what? Missing the mark. If you've target shot, you know exactly what it is. When you miss that bullseye, you've sinned. But if you don't know what a bullseye is, you can't sin because you're not even aiming for the mark. So without the law, sin is not imputed. So the age of accountability is the age where you can discern right from wrong, good from evil. Deuteronomy 1:39, "Moreover, your little ones who you said would become prey, and your sons who this day have no knowledge of good or evil shall enter there. And I will give it to them, and they shall possess it." Who's he talking to there? Hey, man, it's all the kids that were born during that time, remember? They didn't rebel against God. They didn't know right from wrong, so they're going to enter there. So the idea is, if children were born reprobate, we wouldn't be commanded in 1 Corinthians 14:20, "Brethren, do not be children in your thinking, yet in evil be what? Infants, but in your thinking be mature." If they were born reprobate, why are we commanded to become like them concerning evil? Here Paul tells us plainly that they are innocent. If children are totally depraved, Jesus wouldn't ask us to be like him in Matthew 18:2. "And he called a little child to himself, and he set him before him, and he said, Truly I say to you, unless you're converted and become like children, you shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever then humbles himself as this child, he is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. But whoever," note this, "causes one of these little ones who believe in me to stumble, it would be better for him to have a heavy millstone hung around his neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea." The idea is Matthew 19:14, Jesus said, "Let the little children alone. Do not hinder them from coming to me, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. In fact, before we reach the age of accountability and choose to sin, which we all will, we're all the children of God. We have to cause them to stumble. Pastor Chris, in your homily this morning, is all about Paul speaking on Mars Hill. And he was speaking to pagans, and he said this in Acts 17:28, "For in him we live and move and exist, as even some of your poets have said, we also are his children," or God's children. He's talking to pagans. "Being then the children of God, we ought not to think that divine nature is like gold or silver or stone or image formed by the art or thought of man. Therefore, having overlooked the times of ignorance, God is now declaring to men that all people everywhere should repent." Do you think that includes everyone? Absolutely. And he's speaking to pagans and literally saying we're all the children of God until you begin to habitually practice sin. Adam brought the capacity to sin, and with it, death. Will we all choose sin? Unfortunately, yes. Oh, wretched man. Just like Jesus brought the capacity to be reconciled to God. So in the verse in Romans where it says all men are condemned through Adam, and then the very next part of that verse it says all men are justified through Christ, the idea is all men have the capacity to sin and will, and all men have the capacity to be saved if they simply receive the free gift of grace through Jesus Christ. In each case, it's a matter of free will or choice. We all have choice. Folks, we do not fall to fate and say, "Woe is me, it's my fate that I'm like this. Oh, I'm a wretched whatever sin you habitually practice because God sovereignly knew I would be this sinful person and that's the sin he sovereignly determined that I would do." What are you doing with that? Putting the responsibility of your sin on God rather than taking it for yourself. Folks, the simple fact is the Bible from Genesis to Revelation is all about making right choices to serve God, to be holy even as he is holy. All right. Okay, we already read that. So the fact of the matter is this: God does not hold children accountable for the sin of Adam. We inherited death and what? The curse. And it's not until that child sins is he or she held accountable for sinful nature. So the idea is Ezekiel 18:1, "Then the word of the Lord came to me saying, what do you mean by using the proverb concerning the land of Israel, saying the fathers eat sour grapes, but the children's teeth are set on edge?" What he's referring to is the children are going to pay for the sins of the fathers. And you know in Hebrew, father means what? Not just dad. The word here in this passage, it literally means ancestors. Does that include Adam? Absolutely. So literally what we're going to find here in this text, "As I live, declares the Lord God, you are surely not going to use this proverb in Israel anymore because that is not a just God." God says, "No, you're not going to use that proverb in Israel anymore. Behold, all souls are mine." Do you think that includes everyone? "The soul of the Father as well as the soul of the Son is mine. The soul who sins will die." Now note this. Ezekiel 18:19. "Yet you say, why should the Son not bear the punishment of the Father's iniquity? When the Son has practiced justice and righteousness and has observed all my statutes and done well, he shall surely live. The person who sins will die. The Son will not bear the punishment of Adam's iniquity." And that's exactly what he's referring to there. Your fathers, your forefathers, all the way back. "Nor will the father bear the punishment of the son's iniquity. The righteousness of the righteous will be upon himself, and the wickedness of the wicked will be upon himself." It's all about free will. Ezekiel 18:21, "But if the wicked man turns from all his sins, which he has committed, and observes my statutes and practices justice and righteousness, he shall surely live. He shall not die. All his transgressions which he has committed will not be remembered against him, because his righteousness which he has practiced, he will live. Do I have pleasure in the death of the wicked, declares the Lord, rather than that he would turn from his ways and live? Do you think God wants to bless every man, woman, and child on the planet and have them all come to repentance? We really established that. Why did we spend so much time on that? Because I get kind of upset about an affront against the character of a loving, just, and merciful God. We serve a God of love. Amen? Turn to 1 Corinthians 13 and let's just define who God is. Any doctrine that goes against this idea of God is false doctrine. You know that God is love, right? Okay. And it says this, if I speak with tongues of men and of angels and do not have love, I have become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all my possessions to feed the poor, and if I surrender my body to be burned, but do not have love, it profits me nothing. Love is patient. Could we say God is patient? God is kind. God is not jealous. God does not brag. God is not arrogant. God does not act unbecomingly. He does not seek his own, is not provoked, does not take into account a wrong suffered. God does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices in the truth. Hey, God bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. In fact, God never fails. You see, I serve a God that despite my mistakes is like the prodigal son's dad just waiting for me to run back to him. I serve a God who loves. Amen. Jan, what song you and Ashley going to do at the end here? Lead Me to the Cross. Well, come on up. While they're coming up, Romans 2:4 says, or do you think lightly of the riches of his kindness and tolerance and patience, not knowing that the kindness of God leads you to repentance? Aren't you glad that God woos us to repentance? It's his kindness. Because of your stubbornness and unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. Do you think even that verse is all about free will? This morning, God would say, if you're being stubborn in your heart, just run to the Lord. Amen? It's his kindness that leads us to repentance. It's his love and mercy and grace.
Comforts me, strengthens and restores my soul, satisfies my need.
Thank you for listening to Staying the Course with Pastor Brett Peterson. If you would like a copy of this message or would like to submit a prayer request or comment, contact us at 949-888-5777 or email us at info@ccbcu.edu. God bless you as you seek and serve him. Remember, stay the course, and we'll see you next week.
I love your word. I love the way it comforts me, strengthens and restores my soul, satisfies my need.